okay to pose?
No, they're candid shots. Thanks for offering them.
Are you with the Forsyth News?
No, sir. I'm with aboutforsyth.com.
There we go. Come on, Nydia. Vote for Team Bell. Thank you.
I'm just posting now, putting the sound.
Well, write it down, and I'll introduce you, and I've got the other lady here.
Oh, is she?
Would y'all like a t-shirt?
No.
What's that?
Hey, Lydia, how are you?
Hi, Clay. Doing great. Thank you very much.
He is supported by Red Mud Communications.
How you doing, you know?
Red Clay.
Hi, Bill.
How you doing?
Doing great.
Ready to have some fun tonight?
Yes, I think this will be
wonderful. Raise the roof?
Looking forward to it.
I think I'm standing at the wrong side of the room, though.
It's my green.
Hi, Deborah.
Hi, Nydia.
You look lovely.
Make me smaller.
You look great.
Yeah, that's my moniker there.
Nice to meet you.
You too.
Hi, I'm Liz.
Yeah, just today.
Gosh,
it's from your press release.
Good to see you.
Hello, Brad.
Where did you get this camera?
At a beach.
Mike's finally getting a chance to relax now that General Assembly's not.
You are getting excellent sound on that thing. I love that camera. I've seen you fly around using it. That's, if you see me steal that idea,
I'm a basketball.
You know, that's competition, trying to get the better, you know, the better equipment. But that's really good camera.
I'll send you the specs.
Yeah, appreciate that. Well, good luck today. Get some good shots.
Well, we just pick places and talk about it.
Well, thank you.
Hey, Joe.
Side and get the other side good.
I wonder if
ask and ye shall receive.
Thank you very much.
We go. Now we can do video.
Nydia, you really earn your pay. You're out and around filming everything.
Well, I wish I did get paid, but I don't.
I know.
Always wanted to try that. All right, we're going to have a prayer and then we're going to get started.
Please join me. This prayer was first taken and first presented back in the Third Continental Congress, and I've adapted a few words to fit our occasion here. Please join me in prayer now. Lord Jesus Christ, Master of the harvest, the true light coming to the world, grant a fruitful outcome to this debate in a pastoral plan. Holy Spirit, open the heart and mind to the divine call. You make effective every impetus toward good, toward truth, toward charity. Bless this meeting. Inspire the faithful of Forsyth County with zeal and generosity to encourage and to support those whom you call for service to our county, and especially those who are the friends and family members thereof. God bless this organization, this meeting, and all these participants. In Christ's name we pray, and the people said, Amen.
And if you'll stand for the pledge. Pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you for coming. It's a great crowd and a fantastic facility, much more room than we had last month. Next month's meeting will be here as well. We hope to have the 9th congressional candidates and the House candidates for the new House seats in the north part of the county here. And that'll be the third Monday of the month, May the 21st. You should have a flyer that was handed out that has the meeting dates and everything on that. And there's a second flyer that was handed out that was our response to the allegations in Sunday's paper from the former county commissioner, which we won't get into tonight. We don't have enough time to cover. I want to thank all the candidates for coming. We have two candidates not in the debate that I wanted to recognize. Hal Bennett's in the room. He's running for corner. Hal, will you stand up, please? And Mary Beth Pass is in the room. Mary Beth. We've got Mike Dudgeon and Jack Murphy in the back. And we will get started. The candidates are going to stay seated for time, so we won't be walking back and forth, and everyone has a mic in front of them. We've got a lot of questions to cover. We've taken a lot more questions tonight. Well, I don't know that we're going to be able to get to them all. Each candidate is going to have a two-minute opening statement and then a two-minute closing, and each question will be 2 minutes. If the questions can end, if they end faster than that, they can use the remaining time for any other question that was asked earlier or anything that they wanted to address. Our timing person is right here in the front row. We hold the cards. So we have a yellow card that'll be held up at a minute 45 seconds into your question. And then when you get to two, it'll be the stop time. All right. We're going to do opening remarks alphabetically. So that means that Patrick Bell is up.
Thank you, Mr. President. First of all, I'd like to commend my opponents for stepping up to run for county commission, and I'd like to thank the Forsyth County Tea Party for hosting this debate. Being elected to serve as a county commissioner is one of the greatest honors of my life. During this campaign, I'm going to do my best to tell you why I should be reelected and not get into the mudslinging that's already begun. Why should I be reelected? I am the proven small government, pro-business, anti-tax commissioner that works every day to boldly represent the citizens of District 4 and all of Forsyth County. I've been one of the most, if not the most, pro-business commissioners this county has ever seen. While others were saying it couldn't be done, I pioneered the 400 North Opportunity Zone that has attracted private investment, created private sector jobs, and expanded the tax base of District 4. When one of our businesses lost a county contract to an out-of-county dealer for a matter of very few dollars, I champion the local small business initiative that allows us to favor local businesses and return tax dollars to our own small businesses, our citizens. When I ran for office, I promised to listen. As of this date, I've had 5 town hall meetings. When I promised to cut wasteful spending, and I've worked on the elimination of some $20 million from the county budget in the last 3 years. I promised to keep our taxes down, and I've done that. In 2009, there was tremendous pressure to vote for an increase, but I listened to you and steadfastly refused. As a result, there was no tax increase. In 2010, when a massive 1.6 mil tax increase was proposed, I fought vigorously and it was defeated. In 2001, I once again stood up against the tax increase, and you can count on me to do so again in 2012. You see, I've kept my promises to the citizens of Scythe County to be a small government, pro-business, anti-tax commission. Now, some folks say I'm too combative, and to that, well, I plead guilty. But I've fought against some of those powerful special interest groups in this county. Thank you.
Next will be Jim Ball.
Thank you, first of all. Thank you all for coming. It's very nice to see such a large turnout. My name is Jim Boff. I am 60 years of age and have lived in the county about 19 years, serving on the Forsyth County Board of Commissioners for the last 3 years or so, and am retired. This year I was elected chairman by a majority of the board. I have worked hard over the last 3 years to be fair and open to all ideas, and have tried to make good decisions for the county. I have a special concern for homeowners because they are the backbone of the community and have been much abused by governments and some businesses in the last several years, and continue to be. My only goal is to remain your county commissioner. I have no aspirations for any other office at any other time. My focus is nearly entirely on the county. The nature of the questions tonight to me is unknown. However, should questions come up, I just want you to know that I will not generally answer questions about state or federal politics because that's not my focus, and I'm a county commissioner or running for one. But we'll endeavor to meaningfully answer questions which relate to Forsyth County. Thank you very much.
Next will be Dennis Brown.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dennis Brown. I'm running for a candidate for commissioner in District 2. It's a pleasure to be here. Thanks to the Tea Party for hosting us. By the way, I'm the only candidate in District 2 who hasn't filed a complaint against you guys, so welcome any donations to help us beat the incumbent. Not to run against somebody, but to run for something. What I'm running for and what I will proudly stand up for is less government, less wasteful spending, lower taxes, greater transparency, and better ethics. Like most of you, I oppose Clause 7 and will oppose the transportation loss. I also oppose a 15% share of the loss revenue for the city of Cumming. Well, I think that's way too much. What I will support is to take control of county government out of the hands of the powerful special interest groups and put it back where it belongs with the citizens of this great county. Our citizens have been left out of the decision-making process long enough. It's time to chart a new course and take our government back. Just the last few minutes, I'll tell you, I'm a 30-year military veteran. I retired as a colonel after leaving Afghanistan in 2010. And it's been a great honor to serve the country, and I'd like to continue serving for 4 more years at the county level. I have a master's degree from Kennesaw University in international business and a HRM degree from the University of Alabama. I have experience managing multi-million dollar budgets, supervising personnel, rebuilding infrastructure, including the Corps of Engineers in Afghanistan, and a lot of the things that the commissioners have to do here. I'm married to my wonderful wife, Susie, and we're both active members of First Redeemer Church. Please visit my website, votedbrown.com. I appreciate your vote and your support and your presence. Thank you.
Next is John Rutten.
start out a little nervous, but I promise you I'll warm up before the night's over. I know most of you are coming in the back door. But to give you a little bit of background on me, I've lived in the county since 2001. And during that time, I've had an opportunity to serve on a lot of nonprofit boards. Some of those are Leadership Forsyth, Chamber of Commerce, SAF, which is an organization near and dear to my heart, the Rotary Club of Forsyth, and Keep Forsyth County Beautiful. I'm also on the board of the Three Chimneys Homeowners Board. I have a Bachelor of Science from Purdue University and a Master's degree from Keller Graduate School. I, too, am a veteran of the U.S. Army. As a commercial general contractor, for the last 29 years, I've become a trained problem solver. As a business owner, I understand fiscal responsibility and know how to reduce costs without cutting services. I'm committed to sound principles of leadership focused on the future of this county. During this economic downturn, it's critical that the Board of Commissioners work to promote quality job growth within the county. I'm committed to help bring new business and to work with existing businesses to create jobs and maintain positive growth that is well planned and that will follow the county's development plan and codes. I'm committing to working with local organizations, local governments, and our schools to obtain mutual goals for our future. Finally, I understand that the major issues facing us today include solving some of our long-term problems. I'm sure we'll discuss those tonight. Some of those are water issues and traffic congestion. We need to immediately address these issues for the benefit of all county residents. These are some of the reasons that I believe that I will be an effective and responsive commissioner for District 5 and the county. I want the voters to know that my dedication to serve the people of the district and Forsyth County as a whole will always be strong and true in my heart. That is why I ask you for your support on July 31st. Thank you.
And since I forgot, will everyone please check your cell phones, make sure you have them on mute, and will all the candidates please put their cell phones up on the counter where we can all see them, where there won't be any text messages going on during the debate. Next is Tim Hubbard.
Thank you, Steve. I didn't mind the stuff on I'm Tim Hubbard, and I was...
Tim, you need to put your button in front of you.
I'm awful new to this. Been a lifelong resident. Reason I'm running is I made excuses for several years, and I run out of excuses. I love Forsyth County. I've been here all my life. My father's been here all his life. My mother and my grandparents. And the county's been good to us. And I just want to see the same thing for my children, my grandchildren, and so on. And I know in order to do that, we need to keep a low tax base. And I realize spending is out of hand. It don't take very much to look out over the county and just drive through. You can. It don't take long to realize spending is out of hand. And I would like to just, with your support, and if elected, to try to work with people. I try to represent people. I just want to run the best servant of the people. This is what politics has got out of hand. We're supposed to serve the people. And that's what I look to do if elected, is try to serve the people and make sure that there's no big eyes or little U's, that everybody is looked at. And I know I'm not real good with computers, text messaging and all that, but I am good on the phone and I am good to talk to people. And that's the way I'd like to be able to, if elected, is to talk to you one-on-one, not over a text message or an email. I know that's the way things are today, but I still like the old ways. And thank you very much.
Next is Charles Meagher.
Thank you, Steve. I'd like to thank the Tea Party for organizing this event. You did a great job with the sheriff's debate a month ago, and we look forward to this debate this evening. I am Charles Meagher. I'm running for the District 4 Commission seat. I've demonstrated leadership on a broad spectrum of endeavors. I'm a retired 39-year educator. I was a teacher, assistant principal, principal, and central office administrator. My last assignment was as the athletic director and the director of community schools and student activities for Gwinnett County Public Schools. Over those 39 years, I learned that an effective leader was the person who learned to listen and learned to respond to needs, the needs of those he represented. I have an experience, as an elected official. I've been involved in politics as far back as high school and college student government. I have proven electability. I was elected 2 terms of service to the Duluth City Council during the time when Duluth was touted as the fastest growing city and the fastest growing county in the nation. At the time, Duluth had about the same number of voters that District 4 does now. I believe in service. I believe in service to our nation, and I believe in service to our community. I currently serve on the county's tax board of tax assessors, and as you know, the board's purpose is to set value, not taxes. I'm a member of Coming First United Methodist Church, and I've served on the church's administrative board. I currently serve as the trustee for the chapel at Ball Ridge Arena, and the chapel services begin May 6th, and I'd love to see you down there. I'm retired from the Army National Guard after 23 years of service. Those of you who have served in the military or retired former military know their exceptional work ethic and loyalty and sense of duty. I hope you'll recognize those qualities in me over the coming weeks. Thanks.
Next is Cindy Mills.
Thank you. My name is Cindy Jones Mills, and I want to serve you as your next District 4 Commissioner. As I look back on the past almost 50 years of my life, I see a correlation between where I have placed my faith and the most significant events in my life. I see my daughters, and as I place my faith in them, I worked in their schools and coached them in youth athletics. I see my church, and I see the faith I put not only in God, but also in the youth I taught at camps, Bible study, and in Sunday school. I see my community and the faith that I've placed in it by serving on many boards, Park and Recreation Chamber, chartering a Rotary Club, and creating the Gateway Opportunity Program for at-risk kids. Each of these actions that I have worked are reflective of the faith that I have in my fellow man and in my county. I strive to be an example to my children as my grandmother was to me. She walked 10 miles a week to teach school in a one-room schoolhouse for $1 a day because she had a love of community, knew the value of education, and wanted to make her community better, and so do I. I've watched our government up close for many years, and frankly, I've lost faith in the system. I've looked on as these supposed public servants serve their own special interests instead of the interests of the taxpayers. I've watched as they squander our money foolishly, betray our trust, and use their positions to improve their own personal lives and fortunes, and not that of the citizens. A true leader doesn't resort to bullying, and a true leader knows you must show respect to your constituents and to your fellow board members in order to be effective. When your commission meetings begin to mimic a Jerry Springer show, you're in trouble, and I want it to stop. I'm not a politician, but I am a citizen that cares about our county. I want to restore my own faith in government, so I decided to follow my grandmother's footsteps and be the leader she taught me to be. Now I'm asking you to help me to realize that goal, to stand by me and to ask people to vote for me and to go vote yourself, and let's seize the opportunity and make me be your next District 4 Commissioner. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Bill Mulrooney. My wife and I grew up in Gwinnett County, and we moved here in 2000. For anyone interested in learning more about me, please look at my website, BillMulrooney.com. More than anyone else here, I use my site as a place where people can learn my opinions and ideas on subjects that matter and affect our county. I constantly update my site, so please keep an eye on it through the entire campaign. There are 3 main points that I do want to stress tonight. First, the homeowners of District 4 need responsible and ethical representation on the Board of Commissioners. District 4 residents are pretty used to being treated with little respect or just outright ignored. That is going to change. With me as commissioner, the homeowners of District 4 will know that as their representative, I will be their champion. Second, We need responsible and intelligent growth. We have to get out of the mindset that we are simply a bedroom community and that retail equals economic growth. Retail is a byproduct of growth. It's not the creator of it. We need to take responsibility for our own future and bring real companies offering real wages to Forsyth County. Instead of planning around the idea that this is just a downturn in our economy, we need to realize that this is our economy. And as the old saying goes, hope for the best, but plan for the worst. And third, we need to be fiscally responsible. In the past decade, voters have approved $300 million in sales tax for capital improvement projects. The challenge the next board faces will be how to meet these goals and still keep spending down. It won't be easy, but I believe we can do it. Because quite frankly, we do not have a choice. Homeowners simply cannot afford to give up any more money. For tonight, I hope everybody just sits back and enjoys the show. My hope is that for most of you, this is just an introduction to me, and you'll go to my website to learn more about me. Again, it's BillMulrooney.com, and thank you. Have a good night.
All right, we have probably more questions tonight than we're going to be able to get to. We're going to start with the ones that we have, and then we'll go to the, try to get as many in as possible, so if the candidates can please keep it to 2 minutes or less. And we'll continue in the same order that we're doing right now. So, Patrick, you're up for the first question. This is a question for everyone, so everyone's going to be answering the same question. Discuss the current financial health of the county. What are our debts, including bonds, and how much do we have in reserve funds? And how much do you believe is reasonable for the county to save and maintain each year in the reserve funds?
Steve, current financial health, the amount of bonds, the reserve fund, and what else?
The reserve funds and the bonds and the overall financial picture.
Well, in spite of what people have liked to create a picture of gloom and doom, Forsyth County is in great financial health. I've been on the Finance Committee for 3 years. I'm serving my fourth year. And during that time, I'm pleased that we have not only restored a budget that was in a terrible financial mess when I got here. It was $5 million short in one fund and $13 million in another. We have restored that. We have earned a AAA bond rating. We reduced expenses by some $20 million. We receive every year that I've been on the Finance Committee excellence in accounting awards and financial health. So it's not gloom and doom. We are in a great position. Currently, the county has about $270 million in bonds. $100 million is, of course, $87 million is the Parks and Green Space Bond, and the balance is other GO bonds, which is entirely too high, mind you. So our reserve fund sits at 25% of the budget each year, which is an adequate number. Other than that, I don't know what else I can answer except to tell you that this county is a great financial shape.
Jim Bob.
Thank you. I would have to generally second what Patrick said. I would also add that just last week we refloated a bond that saved the county a gross of $5 million, but in net present value, that was about $3.5 to $3.7 million of real savings that was attainable, partially because the bond market interest rates fell. We had someone who advised us that they had fallen and that it would be a good time to take advantage of that, but we were able to take advantage of that because of our bond rating and because, in general, the county is seen as a place where the finances from here are quite good, which isn't true of every other place. I think that's it. Thank you.
Dennis.
Again, I think the county is in really good financial shape due to the work of the commission and a lot of other officials. The AAA bond rating is a very a great status to keep, and hopefully we can maintain that. One of the trends, though, that I see that kind of disturbs me for the future is this trend toward more tax and spend. We're passing more taxes, especially during a time of economic downturn. So a lot of the premier counties and municipalities in this great country of ours have gotten into trouble because they've gotten into this tax and spend cycle. And they were doing very well, and then all of a sudden, it's like we had plenty of money, so we were doing good over all of this time. And then we started taxing and spending and taxing, and it got out of hand. So I think the $270 million in bond debt has tripled over the past few years, mostly spent for good causes. But anytime you spend money that you don't have, it's still debt. Even though it's bond debt, and we're looking to refinance it at a lower rate, it's still debt. And we need to keep that in mind. Every time we take a dollar from the citizens, we need to make a conscious decision that we can spend that dollar on something better than they could, that their family could use. So I'm proud of the county, I'm proud to live here, but I am concerned about the debt load as it going forward. Thank you.
John.
I don't know about most of you, but I think when I moved to Forsyth County, I didn't really look into the financial records of the county and start reading about accolades for accounting awards and things that seem to be prevalent with really out getting right down to the problem. I think that if you look at the debt service of the county, I think it's out of control, and it's been out of control for the last couple of years. And that's one thing that I think that we need to start working on and bring down. I think some of the tax and spend that Dennis mentioned is absolutely accurate. You know, I look at it this way. I get up in the morning and I go to work and I run a business in a bad economy. And I happen to be working in probably one of the worst industries out there. And I think it's time that government take a little more of a business approach and start reinventing. Just because we tax it doesn't mean that we need to spend it. Why are we not building up a reserve to pay for some of these things that we're going to need? Infrastructure improvements, transportation. We're not at that point. I'm not sure how the county runs their finances, but I know how I do it in my business, and I know how I do it in my home. And it's not spend everything that I bring in. It's not out of control. You know, it's a little bit about building the savings account and taking it out of the savings account when you need it rather than going back to the people with your hand out. And that's what I stand for, and that's what I think that I'm going to bring to the county. You know, it's never too late to reinvent yourself. And you don't stop reinventing yourself when you're starting to make headway. And that's where I think that the county's going financially.
Tim Hubbard.
I run a small business as well. And we've had to make a lot of cutbacks. And if I was to say, let me see a show of hands of people in this room that's had to cut at least 30% out of their budget since 2007, everybody in here will probably raise their hand. You see, the county, from the best I can see and what I've been, I don't know the actual number, but from the best that I've been able to see, is they've not reduced their budgets the way that I've had to reduce mine. And the way that you've had to reduce yours. And I think we should have been starting, I mean, I understand 07, but 08, we should have noticed right there, there's something going on, and we need to start cutting. I believe that. We should have started cutting then instead of waiting 3 or 4 years later and saying, oops, we're in mess. I realize the budget, y'all got the budget set, but it needs to be being reduced. Not increase. I wished I could increase my income every year because I don't want to get into that. We've not all had a cost of living increase every year. I haven't. I've made whatever we've worked for to get, then we've saved for rainy days. And we've been in a rainy day, but the fund is depleted. And I mean, it's just common sense government. And that's what I believe we lack is a lot of common sense. Y'all may not see eye to eye with that, but that's the way I look at it. I generally tend to vote my pocketbook. I don't know how you vote, because that's the way I look at it, is if it's going to cost me, I'm not going to vote for it. And we need to get to where we use common sense practices. We need to reduce the budget. I don't care what tomorrow's going to be, but we need to start reducing the budget across the board. Thank you.
Charles Meagher.
The current financial health of the county is sound. The AAA rating is excellent. It's an excellent deal for all the citizens in this county. Is the financial health the same as it was 3 or 4 years ago? No. Are values increasing like we would like to see them increase, the values in our homes and property? No, the values are not increasing like we would like to see, and that has an impact on the tax digest. I believe we're going to be pleased that the tax digest will be as successful as it will be when the reports start coming in. But I have to concur that we do need to start making the plans to use the resources. You know, we don't really have a taxing problem in the county or the state or the nation. We've got a spending problem, and that's what we need to focus on, just to control the spending. Thanks.
Cindy.
I'm thankful that we live in a county that has been and had the luxury of being as wealthy as what we are. But I think if you look at individual people in individual homes, you see a much more greater suffering. And as Tim said, there's people that have had to make sacrifices and cutbacks, and I feel like our county should do the same, and it should be reflective. And I remember several years ago trying to ask people what they would sell their property for, and no one would come near to considering selling it for what the county had it appraised at. Now that is totally reversed, and there's no one or few that I talk to that can think or hope that they could get what the county is appraising their property for. And I think that when we come to real terms with what our property is really worth, and not just what they're being told it's worth, then we are going to have problems. We're going to see that there is greater problems out there, and I think that we are going to have to tighten the belt. I mean, I think that we can't. I look at the green space bond, and when I asked the commissioners and talked to them about doing the green space bond, and I warned at the work session that we can't do this if we don't have an operating budget to go with it. You can't take on $100 million of capital and be expecting that you can use the same amount of dollars to do that. And those are things we have to consider in making the tough decisions. We've got to raise revenue, we've got to take in more money, and we've got to cut back on the operation of things. And if we can't do that, then we're all going to be in trouble. Because I, for one, will never support raising taxes. And the only way you can keep things the same and not raise taxes is by cutting your budget. And I think there's going to be some tough decisions that Board of Commissioners will have to make in the near future.
Go on, Rudy.
Well, I get to go eight, but I still managed to find something here different.
You can go first next if you like.
Depends on the question. Okay. I think it's pretty much been answered on the bonds and our current status. I'm very concerned about the SPLOST settlement that we've just passed. The voters approved it, and with that, they approved an $89 million debt to go with it. And debt is always a bad thing. I don't know how many of y'all, your churches have offered the Dave Ramsey financial peace, but I love the program, and that's kind of how we live our life. No, you know, debt is bad. You have cash, you pay for it. If you don't have cash, you can't afford it. So the $200 million SPLOST projects, we have to be careful that we're not tempted to finance these things, that we're not generating debt with them. We have an $89 million approved debt to go with the jail, but after that, we need to wait until we raise the revenues. If I've heard talk, and I'm not necessarily by anybody in this room, but there's been people who want to be creative with the Public Facilities Authority and get creative with backdooring the debt options that available to SPLOST. And we don't need to do that. We need to let the revenues come in before we pay for things. And that's pretty much all I have to add on my own.
All right, so that's the first question. So just to reiterate how this is going to work, it's not going to always be a packet going first. We're going to go in the same alphabetical order, but the next person will go first, and then the next person will go first, and so on. So at the end of the evening, everyone will have gone first and last, and et cetera. To remind all the candidates, you have a full 2 minutes, so if you wrap your question up, and there's an answer that you would like to challenge, as somebody else stated, you can use your time wisely and do that. That's perfectly fine. It can be a previous question. It can be two questions back. It really doesn't matter. It's up to you. It's your 2 minutes. So the next question.
Steve, may I just answer something on this last one? I think it's very important because I think Mr. Hubbard just knows a good point, so I'd just like to clarify a little bit. Mr. Hubbard said we need to cut the budget. I'm proud of that.
Patrick, we're going to go to the next question. You can use your 2 minutes.
Oh, the next one. I'm sorry. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. So this question is for Jim Ball. Only well, as always, for all, but you're going first. Sorry. What is your position on the millage rate? Is it too high, too low, or equal? Let's go.
Well, the millage rate was not raised. You know, I mentioned that I didn't want to talk about other governments, and part of the reason is because we are not monolithic. We are not comparable. We are not the same as the state. We're not the same as the federal government. Nobody, if the tax was the smallest millage possible mathematically, I think everybody would still want it to be smaller. But the truth is that we didn't raise it last year, and because the general value of land did go down, that's actually considered a tax decrease. I know people don't like to hear that, but that is the way that the numbers work. The taxes have gone up, well, actually several years when I right before I came in office, the budget was around $104 or $105 million here. It'll be around 94-ish, I believe, this year as it was last year. So we have cut. Also, the debt, most of it that you heard about, which is a very large number, this is $250 to $270 million, is by and large tied to water and sewer. And water and sewer is a enterprise fund, which essentially means unless you think you're going to stop using water or sewer if you're on sewer, that has a, I'll call it a virtual guaranteed revenue stream of something, especially if the county grows. I just wanted to be clear on those points to say that I would hope and I will work to try to keep the millage rate where it is this year for the county. I also remind everybody that there are multiple components to your taxes, and that also includes the Board of Education, which for those of you, I believe, below 65 years of age, is a major component of your taxes. Thank you.
Dennis.
I will do everything within my power to keep the millage rate lowest. Right now, our millage rate is the lowest in the 10 county Metro Atlanta area, plus Forsyth County. However, if you take the total tax burden into account, we're third from the highest. And so, you know, Gwinnett, Cobb, and Cherokee don't even have a local option sales tax. So they don't even pay that 1%. And the purpose of that local option sales tax is to keep the millage rate down. So even though we can tout that we have the lowest millage rate and we want to keep it that low, we need to look at the total tax rate per capita that we spend, and we need to do everything we can to keep from raising taxes, is my position.
John, you're up.
I'm not going to be any different than any other candidate up here. I'm going to tell you that I'm going to do everything I can to keep taxes down, low, and I'll work hard to do it. I think that the millage rate is too high. You know, if you sit down and you look at the components, to me the operating millage rate has gone from in 2010 to 3.8 to 4.7. don't get it. I mean, I really don't. To me, it's showing a pattern of increasing, and I think as a county commissioner, you have to do everything you can to get it to roll back. And that's what I'll be committed to.
Tim?
I was way of thinking, but I think it needs to go down. I know it's low, but it needs to be just a little lower. As I said in the outstart, that I wanted my children, my grandchildren, and if time goes on, my great-grandchildren. I don't know how long I'll live, but I'd like for them to be able to have the benefits that I had, or that I have, of being able to live in this county and not have to move because taxes is too high. A lot of folks moved to this county years ago because the taxes was lower here. We're catching up with the metro, well, we're metro now, but we've done caught up with, and we're there. I mean, if we don't get a handle on it now, we're going to be past it. And that's the only thing that I'd like to see. I'd like to see them go down. And I know in order for them to go down, we're going to have to reduce spending across the board. And nobody likes that. I didn't like having to reduce spending whenever everything come slowed up the way that it did. Nobody in here enjoyed it, I don't think. There's many people lost their homes on County Island. But listen, we need to get a handle on it now, not tomorrow, not later. We need to start now. Start now. That's what's the matter with America today. Everybody keeps pumping things off and off and off, and we're to that point. Everybody pushed it on and off to somebody else. And that's where we're at now. So we need to get a handle on it now. And that's what I'd like to see done. If elected, I'd fight for that to see it done. Let's get a hold on these things. And I believe everybody in here believes that, but I don't know if everybody in here wants to do that. You've got to do it. We've got to do it. It ain't a if, it's a got to. We need to. For our children. That's what I'm here for my children and grandchildren. Thank you.
No, I don't much like government. But I recognize that we're going to have a government. And since we're going to have one, we need to have the most efficient one we can. We're going to have a millage rate. It's going to be high or low or whatever the number may be. But as long as we want the services, we're going to have a millage rate. Could it be lower? Possibly. Could it be higher? Well, maybe possibly too. I do want to talk about a business of transparency, though, and it's something that has bothered me for quite some time. You have a constitutional officer in the sheriff's department, and he runs for office, and you and I elect the sheriff. And the sheriff says he needs this much money or that much money in order to make our county safe and secure. And he goes to the commission and says, this is the budget that I need. Well, right now, about 41% of the budget that the commission has control over is sent to the sheriff's office because the sheriff says that's what he needs. We need to have some transparency on those bills that come out every year. I'll fight for the transparency that you get to see the millage rate that your elected sheriff is holding the Board of Commissioners hostage for. So we need to pay attention to the millage rate. We need to know where the monies are going, where the mills are actually attached. I do want to say that I am in that category that a rising tide lifts all boats. And I feel that if the pump is primed appropriately, in our county, values, the our quality of life will rise with the rising tide. It's going to come back whenever it shows up. Thank you.
I agree with Mr. Meagher in that we need just greater transparency in our government spending. I look back on the last, 15 years that I've been watching the commission closely, and I've just been appalled at the frivolous lawsuits that we've gotten involved in with no hope of winning, that we pretend that the money we're spending is more like Monopoly money than it is real money, and that you can't succeed with that. I look at the commissioners that use our county attorney as if he were a counselor or a psychologist, and they won't talk to each other, but they hire him at a lot of money to, for their lack of being able to communicate with each other, they go through him, and that's just wasteful. We have lots of redundancy in service where we have overlaps that we could try to cut. We have, I believe all department heads, including the sheriff, have to be accountable for every dollar that's spent. I think getting a new jail, and we've been told in SPLOST that, and I did not support it and did not vote for it because of it being a special election and because it was a wasteful spending of $45,000 that I didn't think we should be wasting. But I asked the sheriff when he came and talked to our Rotary Club, can we expect to see a drastic increase in your budget once we have the new jail built and we won't be sending out prisoners? And I was told that we could, and I would definitely pay attention to that if I were elected as your representative. I just think that if we can take and we can correct wasteful expenditures, then we can cut our operating costs, and then we should be able to lower millage rate instead of raising it. Thank you.
I have a real simple solution how we can save $5 million on our property tax every year. Quit giving it to the city.
Yeah.
We'll talk about millage rates. The Board of Commissioners really has less than 50% of the responsibility of the tax on their property tax bill each year. Right now, lost amounts, if you look at your property tax bill, you'll see the lost in sales tax, that extra one penny we all pay on every dollar. That accounts for about 9% of your total tax bill, where we give 15% of it right now straight off the top to the city. Before you guys ever get the 9% off your property, the city gets 15% of it, or a total of $5 million of property tax credits is taken from homeowners in the Forsyth County and transferred to a city government that 97% of us have no representation in. We can't vote for it. It's a distribution of wealth. That needs to change. The law says we do have to have a reasonable split, but 15% is way too much. Again, you know, there's a lot has been said at this point. That's pretty much, we're going to have to, it's difficult to sit here and say that you can reduce your property tax. We just have too much obligations at this point to do that. The challenge is to hold it steady and still meet the obligations that were required by law with SPLOST. Thank you.
You have your 2 minutes.
Thank you, Steve. As Jim said, no matter what the millage rate is, people are still going to want it lower. At one time, Forsyth County had a millage rate that exceeded 14 mils. It's now 7.6. And Mr. Hubbard, you're right. We do need to get started, but I got started 3 years ago, and I'm proud of that fact. The 2009 budget prepared by the 2008 board was $104 million. That year I came on the board in 2009, I was on the finance committee. We reduced that $804 million budget to $84 million that year. The following year on the finance committee, I reduced it to $79 million. So I've been there. I've cut. I know how it is. I know how painful it is. I continue to do it. We've had a $24 million reduction in the general fund budget. Ms. Mills was right on the SPLOST projects. I propose that this board provide the taxpayers with a 5-year operating statement on every capital project that was put before you. That was not accepted. I believe you need to know what you're voting on and what the impact is going to be to your budget. You can go back and watch those meetings. It's something that I felt very, very passionate about. Our reserves, and I have to disagree with Bill a little bit, our reserves are fairly healthy. In fact, we'll have a finance committee meeting over the next week or two. It may be where we'll be looking at a tax reduction for 2013. The lawsuits, I have to tell you, I've worked for 3 years. I worked with this board, and we brought them to a close. I came into office with a tremendous amount of lawsuits against the Corps of Engineers and all kinds of people that we should have never been involved with. I brought them to a close, and I'm proud of that. So yes, I've worked for you. I will continue to work for you. I'll continue to watch the budget, monitor the budget, and pet the budget. Thank you.
All right, the next question is for, we'll start with Dennis Brown. This is for all of you. You've already hit on this a little bit, but what is your position on the TSLOST and on LOST? And should the county continue this source of revenue? How should the county approach negotiations with the city on LOST distribution?
Well, first of all, the TSLOST, I'm totally against it. I don't see how we can improve the traffic on Georgia 400 or anywhere else if we're just adding toll lanes. We just need to, you know, make improvements there and do some better traffic engineering. So I'd be against the TSLOST. The other thing it does, it creates a regional bureaucracy. We lose our local control about which projects we want to do. Some board downtown or somewhere else regionally determines which projects we get here in Forsyth County. We need to keep that local control. So I'd be against that. It's just not a good idea. And also Forsyth County, although it's close, would be a net loser of funds. We would send out more money than we would get for projects. The loss negotiations, I think, needs to be separate from the water negotiations. I would think a reasonable split would be somewhere, you know, there's eight factors that go into accounting, how much split each one gets between the city and the county. The population is about 97% county, 3% for the city, so it looks like the tail's wagging the dog. We need to have, or I'm getting into the water thing here, but I would think a split somewhere between 4 and 8% would be a good reasonable split there. Negotiations, we need to improve our negotiations overall with the city. It appears like we haven't had any good faith negotiations, at least according to the mayor. We have disjointed proposals that go across the street, and he just kind of laughs at them. So, and what was the other part, Steve? The question?
The loss and the spots, he's lost. You covered it.
Okay. And, okay. Thank you very much.
Well, I would concur with what Dennis said. I'm not behind the TSLOST, again, for some of the same reasons. I mean, it takes it away from local control. I had an opportunity to listen to what Tom Graves talked about, eliminating the excise tax on fuel and pushing that back down to local control. You know, I would be more of a proponent for that. I mean, if you look at our current transportation plan, we have 167 projects worth about $2.7 billion worth to get in place between now and 2040. Now, I don't care how you do that math. That's a lot of money. I don't have it. You don't have it. We're already being taxed to death. So where are we going to come up with that? I don't see TSLOST solving that problem. The regional control and it not being controlled by an elected official bothers me as well. So yeah, I'm struggling with TSLOST right now. You know, as far as loss goes, you know, earlier Cindy mentioned the Jerry Springer show. I've been watching a different program. I think it's called Survivor Island. And I'm not very happy with that. I'm like most of you, I paid attention to the water contract. I'm absolutely amazed. Somehow over the weekend, we moved that problem to a Rubik's Cube problem. I don't know about you, but I'm not that good at Rubik's Cube. It can keep me entertained for hours. So the time is running out on loss negotiations. I think the first step in that is to try to come up with an effective team that has one program that is combined and has at least one of the five commissioners step forward as a leader.
I'm part of that. And that's way it ought to be on that. I just I'm willing to serve as loyal. On the laws now, I've listened a lot of over the years of between the city and county just getting into a heated dispute. And it will get into that before this is all said and done. But I do agree, it needs to be at a different time than the water negotiations. It really does. But there again, now there's an administration in force right now, and I don't want to get into splitting hairs with them because they need to work this thing out. And what I can say now, what I would do is sort of like armchair quarterback right now. And I don't want to, I'd like to see what they can get worked out, but it needs to be a good bit lower. I don't know what the actual rate should be, but when you get folks to sit down and to communicate for one another, we can come up to a solution that everybody would agree with. But it really, it don't need to be at the same time as you're trying to do the water. But that's something that later on I have to deal with, try to move it to a different time. I don't know how you go about that, but that's something that needs to be looked into to do it, the word you ain't sort of got the tiger by the tail. And that's about how it is right now. We've got to have water. I mean, there ain't no doubt about it. We have got to have water some way, and folks know that. Not everybody's got a way. Not everybody has their own safety tank. So we have got to work this thing out, and we've got to talk to one another. Talk to one.
Charles?
As far as T-SPLOS goes, I'm not in favor of T-SPLOS. One of the biggest reasons, well, let me tell you, first of all, I don't think the T-SPLOS has been outlined and explained to me helps us out. It just doesn't help us out. It looks like all the efforts going into part the top end of the outer perimeter. Now, some folks it will help out if you've got transportation concerns of going downtown. And I feel for you if you do. I took a trip to the state capitol a couple of weeks ago, and it was a two-hour trip with no accidents going down there. I'm not for the T-SPLOS mainly for this. If we put it in, it will never, ever, ever go away. And we'll pay for it, your kids will pay for it, your grandkids will pay for it. There are other ways to accomplish the goals. They may not sound as palatable, but I'll draw your attention back to the founding of the country. Most road systems were toll roads. The people that used them paid the freight, literally paid the freight. Those were government and private enterprise and putting things together to help us get where we're going. I'm not advocating that that's what we do. I'm just telling you that there's other ways to approach the problems we face. On loss, very clearly, it should just simply be based on population. That's what it should be. Thank you.
And looking at T-SPLOS, I mean, I'm grateful that the citizens that do sit in traffic are getting a chance to vote, because I do feel bad that I don't and have never worked in Atlanta, but and I feel for what they face. But I look at it like in raising our children. If when our children behave badly, we keep giving them a piece of candy for behaving badly, they're going to keep behaving badly. And I look at our government the same way. I mean, they've got a lot of money. They've got big budgets, and they have not taken care of it the way they should. And so if we continue through T-SPLOS of giving them more money, they're going to just keep doing badly. So it's time that we step up and that we hold them accountable. You know, you're not getting any more dollars. You're going to have to make this work. When you look at the breakdown of T-SPLOS and you have $12 million for this consulting fee and $12 million for that, that is not good fiscal responsibility. Any way you cut it, it is just not. And I just believe that we have to hold our government accountable now. We've got to say, you're not going to keep getting more. More is not the solution. And I think that it's, and the same thing with lost. I think that we have to look at lost in a different way, because when lost was negotiated 10 years ago, we didn't. The county had not poured as much into infrastructure and into the services that they provide. I mean, now we've got $75 million into water and sewer. I mean, we have, Lord knows, the state of the art in every department as far as in our sheriff's budget and different things that we provide. And we need to look at that and that number. We need to go to the mayor and start low and hopefully get it cut down considerably before we agree, because our county deserves that.
What is your position on the T-SPLOS and the lost? Should the county continue this source of revenue? How should the county approach negotiations with the city on the lost distribution?
Okay, thanks. T-SPLOS, I'm absolutely against. I was against SPLOS 7, but T-SPLOS, I question whether it's even gonna survive the legal challenges, because you're taking tax money and giving it to unelected committees, regional committees. So I really question whether it's even going to survive the legal challenges. But yeah, here's a great idea. Let's take another $34 million out of the tax base here in Forsyth County and ship it off to some other part of the state. Just makes no sense. It's no good for our county. I do think the question needs to be asked, do we want to renew this thing before we jump in and do it? Now, as I said earlier, lost is 9% of our property tax. It shows up as 9% off on the property tax. So, you know, I think the pushback from the tax base, if you eliminated that credit, it would be a tax increase. But lost, you think the water negotiations have been fun to watch? Wait till we get to the lost negotiations. These are going to be a hoot. And please watch my website, because I'm going to keep a running commentary on these things. There'll be arguments back and forth, and it'll be real clear which commissioners are arguing for the city and which ones are arguing for the county. The basis should start at population, which is about 3%. The county, 3% to the city, and 97% to the county. But remember, all the taxpayers. This is not a tax on business. This is a tax on the consumers. In the entire base, city and county are all consumers. So there is no such thing as in one group of people that doesn't benefit from this loss. It's 100% of taxpayers, whether they live in the city or not. So again, this is going to be very interesting. I think the population needs to be where the starting point is. From there, we can look at services. But you know, when you get right down to it, the city doesn't provide that much in the services. So, thanks.
T-SPLOS is something I've had concerns with since I originally heard about it, and in kind of a different avenue than I've heard tonight. And one of them is I have real trouble with generating revenue, sending it to GDOT, who's proven that they can't manage a budget and expect them to do a better job than they did before. If the money were controlled here locally, I'd be more inclined to support it, but right now I'm struggling with that notion. It's going to create some tough decisions for whoever's on this board in the future, whether it's next year or 5 years or 10 years down the road. The fact of the matter is these projects do need to be completed and they do need to be paid for. We just don't know where that money's going to come from, what the appropriate program is. It is a fact that the state set up board of commissioners was originally commissioners of roads and bridges. So ultimately it is our responsibility for transportation projects, and they will have to be funded. But I'm not totally comfortable with the project as it is, the program as it is now. Lost, I think, is a great program. It rolls back our top property taxes with collections from, we had anticipated, I've been told, 38 to 40% out of county. Now, I don't know if that number is correct, but if it's 1% or 2%, I'm happy to accept that because it rolls back our property taxes. When we come to the split with the city, I believe that we have to negotiate pretty hard. We do need to, I think, have water included in that because that is a service. We do need to have a service delivery strategy somewhat nailed down because that is a big part of the lost split. As far as percentages goes, I don't know yet. I'm thinking 10 or below would be an appropriate number, but that has a lot to do with the services that we're going to provide versus what they're going to provide or they
Thank you.
Thank you. First on T-SPLOST, I definitely hope that the people inside the Atlanta region pass their T-SPLOST. I like their projects, and I like them to pay for them. But as it relates to us, I think that my real gut says I shouldn't say anything and let people decide for themselves, but I guess I'll say that I'm mildly not in favor of T-SPLOST. But only mildly, because as everyone said, these roads have to be built. I don't know that it ever was the case. The tax money to the state got spent pristinely, as we all would wish, and I don't actually know whether this is worse or in some ways better than other ways that we've had. Sooner or later, we will have to build at least some of these projects, and then, as Patrick said, the money has to come from someplace. So I don't know whether I've given you a politician's answer on T-SPLOST or not, but that's how I think I feel about it. The other part is the Lost and the as it relates to water. I think Lost is a good idea. It does roll back property taxes. Like almost everything in almost every government, it is not perfect. It has problems with it. One of the problems is coming up with the split or the, you know, what's fair. I will attempt as much as I can to be driven by where the value is for every dollar that we would split with the city or any other government, if it ever came to that. My question is always going to be, what value do we get for that dollar or those dollars? The same thing is true for me on the water. The issue is not so much, is water valuable? We all know that it is. The issue for me is, what does it cost, and why should we pay any more than we have to for it? And so far, I haven't heard good answers to that question on T-SPLOST or on the water, or on the Lost split. Sorry.
All right, we're three questions in this evening, so I'd like to make a recommendation if all the candidates are in approval and can agree on this, but if we can go to 1 minute on the answers, we've got tons of questions. We're not going to finish this. We're not even getting close at the 2 minute rate. Are you all good with that? All right, so we'll go to 1 minute, talk faster, and let's get to the point. John, you're up. So the next question is, there's an effort to build and support an equestrian center on the north part of the county. Why could the county not use the existing equestrian facilities at the city's fairgrounds instead of paying and maintaining a separate facility? And would you support this proposed equestrian center to pay for with taxpayer dollars?
Well, let me say this. You know, when I was a kid growing up, parks to me were something that we enjoyed. I grew up in a family that didn't have a lot. We lived a couple of blocks from the park, and that's where I spent my day. Baseball, you name it. We did it all at the park. To me, a park is a multi-purpose type facility. I think that once you start taking the Parks and Rec and focusing in on a segment of the market, then the government now is competing with private enterprise. And from my perspective, I just don't see that as the role. From my perspective as well, we should look to have some maybe public-private enterprise partnerships where we work on something like that, where the park department might have the benefit of a private facility.
Tim, you're up next.
I'd like to say on this issue, I've been fortunate that I grew up on a farm, and most folks that I know with horses are either boarded somewhere or have their own farm. Now, I realize a lot would like to place this on the county, and I realize that, but we need to look at if it's profitable. I believe private enterprise would want to take it up and go with it. That's what I think, if it's profitable. Now, if it ain't profitable, We don't, I mean, that's what's the matter with things we've invested in. They're not profitable. I can understand investing in something that we'll turn a profit with or be able to upkeep, pay for itself, pay for your employee, pay for your health care, pay for the upkeep. So that's something I believe that folks is overlooked. All these things are well and good, but we've got upkeep with it. There's a lot of upkeep there that folks don't think about. The upkeep, it ain't so much building the park or the center, it's keeping them up. And there's a lot of upkeep there. We need to watch that for the future. The future there.
Can you respond back on the loss? I did not complete the answer about the loss. I'm very much in favor of the loss. I think it's a voluntary tax. If you don't want to participate in loss, you can buy your products online or some other county that doesn't charge that kind of fee. As far as the equestrian center, I am against us operating an equestrian center. I'm against us buying the golf course. I'm not against, and I don't think the equestrian center was vetted through the proper folks. We have an excellent board system in this county, the library board, the parks and recs board, the planning and zoning group. We have excellent board system. I don't believe this equestrian idea came through in a proper vetting manner. And I think Cindy, you'll probably be able to address that a little bit more clearly. But I do want to second Mr. Derucki's comments about a public-private relationship. I think those kinds of things are something that we can look forward to.
Cindy?
I am not opposed to horses, but I am opposed to when systems that are in place, like boards, are not used the way that they were intended to. I don't like to see projects become something about a political campaign and not about what's good and what's best for our county. I don't think that we, as a government, should be meeting the needs of every hobby that's out there. I think we will bankrupt ourselves immediately if we try to do that. I think that, you know, there's ways. I definitely do not believe in putting private businesses out of business. And I have had many that have reached out to me that are in that vicinity and they're upset and they're saying that it's not fair. And I don't think that's, I just think in this economy, we have to look at things realistically, and the operation, the operating cost of an equestrian center is astronomical by what I've been told.
I'm against the equestrian center. I would not be against the concept of maybe some horse trails. It's a beautiful property back there, a little extra parking for some trailers. But the full-blown equestrian center, it makes no sense. I've been doing a lot of research on this. This is a 35-acre facility, proposed facility. There's a privately owned 85-acre facility 2 miles away that we would be in direct competition with. Now, I've also learned a lot about the maintenance that involved. And as Mr. Hubbard was saying, it would be high-end maintenance. I never understood this, but you would think it'd just be a field with a fence around it. The footing involved, what they call the footing, the ground that these horses work off of, is a very technical layered surface. It requires maintenance every time it rains. Now, then you have all these stalls with 2,000-pound animals in there. I mean, it's just the maintenance aspect of it. By my estimation, this would require a staff of 6 at least. It's just not a business we need to get into. I'm not against horses, maybe a trail, but I am against the equestrian center. Yeah.
Thank you. This issue has become a political point by one of my opponents. This issue was taken to our staff. It was then taken to the Board of Commissioners, of which it was a 5-0 vote to send for more information. We're in the information gathering stage. A public-private partnership may be there. I have pledged that I would not even consider a project like this unless it were revenue neutral. There will be no cost to the taxpayers. But the issue is, this is a political stunt. It's not indefinite. It's in the investigation stage. It's been approved by our Board of Commissioners. I find it ironic that somebody that is so concerned with the vetting process bypassed the vetting process to sell property to the county and bypassed it and took it directly to the chairman.
Now, that's an interesting concept for me. But rest assured, this is not a definite deal. I don't agree that the county should pay for it either. Thank you. Thank you.
I do agree we were in information gathering mode. However, I have talked to several people, and I will at least say this right now. The information I have gathered does not make me optimistic that this is something that I would be for.
Dennis?
Yeah, I would be opposed to that from what I know about it, because it would compete with a lot of smaller farms. I know it's half the size, there's a lot of smaller horse areas there. Unless there was some way we could compete with Kentucky with the running of the roses and all that. I just don't see that happening, so at this point I'd have to be against that.
The next question is kind of long, and Tim, Mr. Buren, we'll start with you. Do you feel that it was ethical for two county commissioners to schedule a private meeting with the EPD and to include the mayor and going to the current board of commissioner, chairman, and another county commissioner and staff and already scheduled a meeting with the EPD? All this happening while the county and the city are negotiating a contract. If elected, what would you do to change the protocol so that our county is properly organized and represented when discussing issues or contracts with outside entities or intergovernment agreements?
Just as I said earlier, we need to work together. City and county needs to work together. Whenever there's something coming up like this, it needs to be brought before the people. I know and I realize what maybe they was, I can't think for them, but I'm assuming that they was trying to maybe save the taxpayers money by not having to call a meeting. You know, they may have been. But I believe the best thing is if we're going to talk about these things, you need to get set down, get everybody together, and let's all talk about it together where folks can hear. That's why I think folks is upset between the county and the city, because the county ain't got a clue what's going on until it's done pass. And then you go, what? And that's the way it is. And that's why there's trouble right now between the county and the city, because it's just like, I didn't know that. And we need to get this set down and have a meeting to get everybody together and on one page and let the people know. Thank you.
Charles.
Thank you. The people that hold elective office are important to the community. Everyone here could be a commissioner. I'm proud to be on this side of the table applying for this position from you. But having said that, they're all independent people, as you can see here tonight. It's kind of like herding cats to try to get them all to have one point of view, to have one source of meaning. I think the real issue, particularly in this last episode, is about the water and what the county needs. It needs its own water intake. How we get to that point is yet to be determined. I think some lawsuits are coming to their end in the next year, 18 months, and I think that we'll have a clearer path to get what this county needs, and that's our own water intake. Thank you.
I think that it's very important for a board to be united, especially when you're going, I think that you can watch the mayor and how he works with his city council. And I think he's in 40 some odd years, he's had one no vote. And I think that we can't hardly agree on anything. And we need to be united. We need to have five county commissioners that represent the county and the county's interests.
Ethical, yeah. I mean, there probably wasn't an ethical violation when they're meeting two by twos again. Dysfunctional, absolutely. The solution to this problem is real simple. You guys have the solution. July 31st, you make the right choices, this problem goes away.
Patrick.
Thank you, Steve. I absolutely don't believe there's any ethical actions on the part of my fellow commissioners. Even though it's very similar to the meeting that our esteemed AG has opined was a violation of the Open Meetings Act. Going back to a couple other things quickly, on the equestrian facility, it's interesting, there's three companies that have contacted me. One is opposed to it, two are very supportive because they believe it will build the industry in that area. As far as commissioners all getting along, if you guys want a board of wallflowers that just agrees on everything without vetting it out and yes, even arguing about it, I would suggest that that would be a detriment to the taxpayers. You want a board that will bring different ideas to the table and yes, hash them out and come up with the best decision for the county. Thank you.
Jim.
As it relates to the water, I don't think that there was anything unethical about the meetings. I wasn't thrilled about them, largely because I fought very hard, and those of you who followed it in the newspaper, very, very hard on several occasions to try to make it so that the county had a group which would be an open group and would have to conform to the open meetings laws and requirements in order to go over to talk with the city, so that everybody would be able to, who was, had an interest in it, see what the negotiations and the discussions were all about. And at every turn that I tried to bring that, to produce a group or a situation which would have commissioners meet with the city in an open meetings environment, somehow or other that got changed or never came to fruition. So I too think that we need to work together and wanted to work together, but I was unable to accomplish it in an open meetings environment, which is where it should have been.
Well, technically, it probably wasn't an ethical violation. However, the perception of the public is that, you know, we need to do a better job of working together for a solution. And to be a good leader, you need to be a good follower. So sometimes you need to sit in line and support the chairman and get some of this important legislation done. There's nothing more important than water. And so here we are, we're going out with these different proposals. And if nothing else, there's a strong perception that they're just not working together. There's special interests at work. People are doing things behind the scenes for interests other than the people's, and it's just wrong.
I don't think it was an ethical issue, but I don't think it was the brightest thing I've ever seen. I mean, I came to the town hall meeting, and when I learned this, I was flabbergasted. I mean, seriously, we broke up into pairs and we went down and we met with the EPP director. What possessed you to think that he was going to negotiate anything with you? I mean, I just don't get it. You know, it takes a lot of personal courage to get up here. And I'm not just speaking for myself. I mean, every candidate, whether you're running for re-election or this is your first go at this thing, it's not easy. But I'll tell you that while you're doing this, there are things that you have to look for that get you fired up, that keep your head in this race, keep you focused on doing the right thing. And after that town hall meeting, I was convinced that I'm doing the right thing. And you know, you gotta have thick skin, but you gotta keep pushing forward. And that was one of the things that is driving me right now.
Charles, next question is we'll start with you. A debate is a very important part of our election process. It allows our citizens to be able to ask questions and to allow each candidate a chance to challenge others' answers and issues. If you are elected to be commissioner, do you feel that an elected official owes it to the citizens of our county and to your constituents to attend a debate during an election year? Or as an incumbent, would you not show up for the debate? If so, why?
Somehow, I feel that's not really addressed to me. I believe in openness. I believe that you should be present to present your views and you should stand. You know, this is a job interview. We're here to interview for a position.
And I don't think it's a one-shot deal. It's an ongoing kind of thing. I believe in listening to the constituents. I believe in learning what it is the community wants to do. There's nobody up here that's magic. We are spokespersons of what the community wants to do. And if you're not willing to stand in the heat of the kitchen, I suppose, then this may not be the kind of environment with the kind of position that you want to be involved in. Thank you.
I definitely feel like that the debating process, while it can be nerve-wracking, it is very important to participate, and I believe in the transparency and being able to engage with your constituents. I applaud each of you for being here tonight, because I know you've all got busy lives and something you would probably be enjoying much more, especially my nieces, they're going yes, yes. But I think it's so good to be a part of the process, and I applaud the Tea Party for the way they've been sending people to meetings and watching, because it can make us all be better as public servants. The more people engage in the process and the more that they watch what's going on, it's a lot of money. It needs to be watched. And I think any time that you can, people know they're being watched, it's good. And that's why I started the focus on Forsyth Side when I did. And I just think that it's good for people to know what's going on.
Bill?
I don't know what they're talking about. I'm having a blast. You know, it's real simple. I'm asking you to put me in a place for 4 years. I'm asking for you to let me represent you for 4 years. Then I should be willing to come out and talk to you and meet you, and that's why you'll see me walking neighborhoods. You will see me going door to door with people, because you know I want to make sure I know the people I represent. So that's why I'm here tonight.
Thank you. Absolutely, debating is a key component of the political process. It allows the voters and citizens to see what each person has to offer, and I do appreciate all of you coming out. It's a busy time. Everybody's got things going on, and I appreciate it. You will not find a commissioner who puts more into meeting with his constituents, answering the emails, answering phone calls, and going out to visit them than myself. I've even had opponents back on the YMCA days that were against me on the YMCA project, but they had the respect to stand up and commend me for at least dialoguing with them continually on the project. So yeah, I believe that you need to be out there meeting with the people.
I believe kind of strongly personal choice. I would say if a person chooses not to be in the debate, that's something you all have to consider the importance of. I consider the debates important. Within certain limits, I think that national politics, but I believe those debates went on too long, and you can actually get tired or unnecessarily stirred up about things that you can't control. But that doesn't describe this situation at all. And I'm very glad to be here, and I'm glad everyone who is here is here. Thank you.
Brian, what do you think? Absolutely, you should be here. These are your constituents. These are the people we're going to be working for. And I think it's an insult for you not to be here. Probably who's hosting the debate here has something to reason the incumbent's not here. Thank you.
John.
I absolutely believe that you should be here. I mean, obviously, we're talking about the empty seat to my left. But let me say this, because I was recently asked by another group of people to participate in the debate that I had a very difficult time with, because date that they wanted to have it is on a date that I have to be in a competition for
for a very large group of people that I promised long before I decided to get into this race. So, yeah, I believe that you should be here, you should participate, and, you know, unless it's some huge commitment that you just absolutely can't get around or it's an illness, then obviously, you know, you got to do what you did, what you have to do. So hopefully, maybe Brian will make it up tonight somehow. I don't know, maybe an ice cream social or something over the next.
Yeah. I do think it's good for us to have these debates for people to see us. I don't know and realize what terms, I don't know if it might have been due to sickness or family or what. Now that's I don't know these things, but I'm sure if there was a conflict, somebody could have rearranged the time and all, I believe, but I don't know what happened, but there again, I wasn't there. So I don't want to try to judge nobody on account of that, because I don't know what his conflict of interest was. But we do need to be here. I think we do, unless there's, you know, family matters or sick. There's certain things you just can't, answer for, unless, you know, I don't want to be in his shoes if he is sick. I don't want to be in his shoes if he's got family problems, and I sure don't want to be in his shoes if he just didn't come.
However, the person you complain against is covered by the county taxpayers. So, you know, we've tinkered with the ethics ordinances. We've made them just about toothless. Ken Girard likes to use bright lines. He likes to talk about bright lines. Well, we've just taken and smashed a whole bunch of bright lines in the last 2 years. They need to be, that needs to be turned back to where the ethics matter.
Yes.
Do you feel it's a conflict of interest that county commissioners appoint a representative to the ethics board? And if so, how should they be appointed to the board?
Thank you. I had misunderstood the question, because the board of commissioners appoints one of the five. Constitutional officers appoint one. Employees appoint one. Those choose one. It's a very complicated process. But yeah, I think that it's fair enough. It's certainly not that the Board of Commissioners can overrun that board, but you still have to have a majority vote to make anything happen. So I think it's time to wait.
Jim?
I think it's okay the way that it is, but you know, now we get into the issue of cost, which then gets into the issue of taxes. I know a few of the people who are on the Ethics Board, and one or two of them, not that the others aren't, but I don't know everybody on there, one or two of them are among the very smartest people that I have ever met, and yet they're struggling with some of the rules and some of the responsibilities that they have. I actually think at some cost to the citizens, we could have a better system, but it might entail having a list or a pool of people trained in the law, perhaps all the way up to having lawyers who, on an ad hoc basis, on an as-needed basis, get asked to sit in on certain things, but only after they've had specific training in how to be an ethics board. But again, then that requires some expense.
Dennis?
I think if nothing else, there's an appearance of a conflict of interest anytime you have an oversight or a governance of a board by the people that appointed. It certainly creates a perception that there's no impartiality. Nothing against any of the board members or any of the commissioners, but I just think any very functional ethical system, you need independent people appointed by other agencies so that it's clearly they don't have any interest or when they make the decision. So I think it needs to change to have it appointed by, I don't know, maybe a judge or some panel of independent citizens, but there's just no way that you can have clean oversight of a board that appoints the ethical ethics board.
John Russell.
I agree a lot with what Dennis just said. I think that the whole process should just be completely eliminated from the Board of Commissioners. I mean, I don't understand why we can't go out and have a group of clergy, you know, make that appointment. Anything to remove it. I agree with what Bill said. I mean, we've been revising this thing, I mean, I'm going to put right up there with the sign ordinance and the alcohol ordinance. That we've had, multiple renditions of. So, why have any connectivity between an ethics appointment and any member of the board? It's not necessary. It's I don't see where it saves us cost, it saves us time, it reduces operating costs. There's got to be a very simple solution to this problem.
Jim Hubbard.
I think on this issue, we're supposed to be honest with people. We're supposed to be. That's why you elect us, I believe, with all that's within me, is to be honest with the people. And as far as ethics and the attorney fees and things like that, if you take us in our if we're elected and we're in this spot, if it becomes a point that if we get in trouble for not telling the truth, I guess the best way to put it, or trying to stretch it a little bit. If it comes out of our pocket, a percentage of the money comes out of our pocket to have to pay the attorney fees, man will watch what he does. Man will watch what he says, and he'll be extra careful. Because like I said, punch your money where your mouth's at. I've always said that. Now, if it's going to cost you for messing up, you're a lot careful with what you do. I believe that. Y'all may not think like that, but I believe a lot of you think like that. I tell you, I'm just common. That's all I am. I ain't polished up and I ain't shined up or nothing. I'm just a team. That's all I am. That's all I'll ever do. And I'm nothing.
As I said earlier, I'm very much a believer in the board system that we have in the county, and I think we have some of the finest people that you'll want to meet working on the various boards. For instance, the way they operate the Board of Tax Assessors for works. If you're there and you don't like the results that you've gotten from the Board of Tax Assessors, who, by the way, are appointed by the Board of Commissioners, your next step is to appeal it to the Board of Equalization. The Board of Equalization is appointed by the Superior Court Judge. So there's another layer, another level. I think the board would be fine to avoid the perception, though, maybe if there were ethics charges against a commissioner, that would be heard by a different board. Again, I'm very much in support of our board system, though. Thank you much.
All right, the next question, we'll start with Bill Mulrooney. The city and the county have been at odds over water contracts for several decades. What is your position on the water contract as of renewal, and how would you get the support of other government leaders to ensure that Forsyth County citizens get the lowest water rate possible?
Actually, if you guys are walking in the door, you might have seen that I was handing out my position on water, and you really can't discuss this in a minute or less. Bottom line, I think the problem stems from the fact that, you know, the county doesn't have water. We don't have a source of water. The city does. It's been like that for 30-something years. The demographics of the county changed. The people in charge of the city haven't. And that's the bottom line. The city has gotten very used to the revenues generated. I mean, they buy everything in cash. They carry no debt. Well, there's a good reason for it: lost in water. So they need to be weaned off of the foresight of the taxpayers. They need to be weaned off of the county. Now, that is not, like I said, I'm on the way in, if you guys didn't get it, probably somebody around has it. I've shown my water proposal. What I would say would be a good starting point. But the ultimate goal of the county has to be our own straw. We have to have our own source of water. We have to become self-reliant.
Thank you. Go back to the last question on the ethics issue. There's, again, some misconceptions out there. If the official is found guilty of wrongdoing, the county doesn't pay for it. The component where the person that filed the complaint has to pay is only to protect you, the taxpayers, from activists that use the ethics board as a punishment tool and waste your tax dollars over and over and over again. When it goes to the water contract, back to that, it's important to note that lowest rate is not the most important component. I don't know about you, but if I were in the hospital, I wouldn't want the cheapest IV to pump it into me. I'd want a pretty good one. The bottom line is we need a safe, secure, and reliable source of water for decades. That's the components, and that's the job that I'm trying to do.
Thank you very much. Again, I'm a person who wants to see value. In my previous career, we made printed circuit boards of various kinds, and we would have customers come in and say, you have a five-layer printed circuit board with approximately this many components on it. They'd get out a chart and say that, according to our charts, is worth about this much. Keep your price list. We're willing to pay you 15% of what we say it costs you to produce this stuff. From that, what I have learned is that what you should say is, and I have no reason to believe there's anything whatsoever wrong with the quality of the water we get. That's not the issue. The question is, why should we pay more than we have to? And again, I haven't heard a good explanation of why we should pay more than we have to.
Well, the bottom line is Forsyth County needs water independence. That's the bottom line. And we do that by sitting down in good faith negotiations with the mayor and our state elected officials, go to the EPD, go to the Corps of Engineers, and work these out collectively. And we don't need to keep this a political football at odds in special interests working against the citizens' interests. We need to deal with it. We need to deal with it before this election and not kick it down the can down the road. And water is the most important issue facing us with the regional water wars. We need to deal with it in a professional manner, and we need to do it now.
All
Well, we better have a short-term plan because time is running out. And, you know, in my day job, I have the opportunity to negotiate a lot of contracts. And when your back is up against the wall, you don't have much room to move in. So we've got to come up with something quick. We're going to be forced into making a deal with the city whether we like it or not. I personally don't like it. Part of my plan would not include paying the $11.4 million invoice that the mayor sent over to the county. I think that's a negotiating ploy. So, I said this earlier, I'm kind of flabbergasted. It's one of the things that drives me. It's not just the issue of the water, it's how we're handling the issue of the water and our ability to show leadership and step in there and address this issue. Time is running out. You know, we better start working on an effective long-term problem and create some independence in here, but not forgetting the amount of money that we have invested in the infrastructure that we have out there. So if we can find a long-term solution, if we can work together, then that's what we should do.
I believe in the early 70s, whenever the city first went to Lake Lanier to do an intake, I believe that's what it was, just a thing. Don't quote me on that, but I'm thinking. But I think the county was offered opportunity, but they didn't want it at that time. Didn't see a need for it. I believe, I ain't 100%, but I've heard a lot of tales over the years. And now, we're in a mess. We need water. Water's our life. We got to have water. And as far as another source, you know, the county at one time bought some property down at the lower end of the county, was going to do that down there. And Corps Engineers and EPD shut that down. I believe what we need to do with some of the money that was spent, we need, in the early days, we need to look, we're going to have to look northwards for another water solution. I don't know how to go about that, but I know it's not coming out of Lake Lanier or the Chattahoochee because of the stuff that's up with the Tri-State Water Board.
Charles?
We do need to have a short-term solution, but we also need to have a longer-term solution. There's several, as I understand it, there's several plans on the table right now that are being reviewed. I don't have a particular comment on any one of those plans. I hope that we can find something that gets us through to the short, during the short term, but we need to work on that water intake. We need to have our own straw, and I think that will come as soon as some of these lawsuits go away. Thank you.
And Cindy.
Just what Charles said about eventually hoping and being wishful that we will get our own water intake and investing tremendous amount of money into our own infrastructure as far as water and sewer. We've spent $20 million on a finishing plant so we can finish our own water. And so you have to say, well, if we're going to continue to buy finished water from the city, why did we do that? And then you look at the raw water contract and you look at the different prices that are being offered from different commissioners. And the bottom line is we want water independence. And I know that that's something we've all been wishful for a long time, but why would we want to get into another long-term contract and if we have hopes of being independent? I don't understand that.
All right, last question, then we'll go to closing remarks. Patrick, this one will be starting with you. Employee benefits account for approximately $17 million of our budget. County employees have an incredibly rich health and dental plan that is paid almost entirely by the county. Accumulated sick days are able to accrue for up to 6 months and can be saved for a year. Do you think that these benefits are in line with the private sector employees? If you were to make changes in benefits, what changes do you feel would be appropriate?
Well, we have been making changes to those plans. We've been increasing the employee contribution for years. It was planned, put into place by the previous board, and this finance committee is actually going to be increasing that to comply with federal law. I do believe it's a good plan. I don't believe it's an overly rich plan. I think that our staff is some of the best in Georgia, actually some of the best in the Southeast. We have a tremendous staff. They've gone for years without any cost of living increases. And I don't think the cost of living increases are automatic, but they have sacrificed as much as anybody else. But no, I don't believe it's an overly rich plan. It's a good plan, and they will be paying more for it over time.
Jim?
I generally agree with that. We have tremendous staff, in my opinion. From time to time, I hear complaints about this, that, or the other thing, but I don't hear anything that sounds like a pattern to me in terms of my little over 3 years here. We have cut back in previous years on the number of vacation days that employees get. We have cut back on the COLA. We have increased the payments that they do make to their insurance plans. And I plan to keep things reasonably in line there. But I do, when you say the private sector, it means you have to define what part of the private sector. Some of the private sector gets stock options. Some of them get stock. Some of them get bonuses. Some of them get big expense accounts. Many things that essentially, for the rank and file, don't exist at all in government. Not that I'm trying to make anybody feel bad for people in government, but it's not quite the same to say that everything is the same between the private sector and this government. Thank you.
Okay.
Well, as in the private sector, I think these are undergoing cost of revision and assessment. I would think we would like to keep a lucrative package that's fairly consistent with other fast-growing counties to attract and retain quality people. So I think that's important. However, it shouldn't be out of line or more extravagant than what you could expect in the private sector. So we keep good things. So there's a balance there. And I think it needs continual readjustment. We need to look at it often and adjust it as necessary.
John.
One of the toughest things that you have to do as a boss or an employer is to take a look at employees' benefits and their salaries. I'm a firm believer that if you're going to do that, you need to step up and take the smack first. So any cut in benefits, salary, whatever, should be led by the board commissioners. I think that one of the overall plans that we should take a look at, and it might be a little bit different than what other counties do or what county employees are used to doing, is start looking at small COLA increases, but incentivizing them at the same time with a bonus plan. Why not? I'll bet you if you sat down one-on-one away from a department manager in this county building and you asked that employee, what can you do to help cut the cost in this county? I will guarantee you, you're going to come up with some brilliant ideas. And I think that needs to be part of the process as well. I think we have to look at, as the county grows, what we do with new employee packages and take a look at those. Thank you.
Yeah.
Like has already been said, and I'll have to agree with it as far as keeping up with the current different ones. We're going to have to look every year at how things are and try to keep everyone along with a steady playing field. But also, I'd like to say, on a lot of these things, just as he just said, you need to talk to the employees and talk to them and see, to me, what can we help you in a certain way? What can we do better that will help this? And it'll save money in the long run. Folks get on up as far as get to be bosses. When you become a boss, you're never supposed to tell an employee to do something that you'll not do yourself. I've always, if I say something to one of my employees, if they don't do it, I'll do it myself. And generally, if they won't do it too many times, I'll generally fire them. Because if I'm going to have to do it, I don't need them. And that's the same way we should do it. We need to sit down and talk with people and work things out.
Charles.
Traditionally, public employees gave up higher salaries for a better benefit package. And private industry kind of went the other way. But times have changed. The economies have changed a great deal in the last 3 or 4 years. The benefits package right now, I don't know whether it's too much or too little, but I do know that it needs to be looked at, reviewed constantly. Thanks.
Andy.
I admittedly know very little about our benefit package that our county employees have at the time, but I do know that this past November, that we had commissioners that were trying to vote themselves in a lifelong health insurance package that would keep them covered, even if they served 4 years in office, that they would be able to continue to have their health insurance until they found a real job or another job, or until they went on Medicare. My dad's trucking company, if we tried to, a part-time employee, if we tried to provide them with health insurance, we'd be broke in 6 months' time if we tried to do what our commissioners were trying, some of our commissioners were trying to do last November. We need to keep it real. We need to, I'm with John, we need to have less benefits for our county commissioners and not to be looking at lucrative packages to give them more and more.
Well, Cindy, you stole some of my thunder. I was going to bring that one up, too. But I think that plan was, and Mr. Bell was a proponent of it, was to extend for every year you served in elective office, you got a year of benefits. As Mr. Meagher said, quality benefits, you need quality benefits to get quality people. Ask people whether they'll take a cut in pay or cut in benefits, they'll take a cut in pay. Benefits have just gotten incredibly expensive from a private standpoint. People just can't afford it. You go to work for benefits. A lot of what we do on the county level, we have no control over. Obamacare is, you know, when you have things where the county has to pay for dependents to the age of 26, you know, there's certain things that we're not going to have control over, but everything on the budget every year needs to be looked at from the bottom up. Everything. Benefits, all of them. Thanks.
That concludes, for the timing at least, the questions that we have this evening. I wanted to thank all of you for coming tonight. Thank all of you for attending tonight. And we're going to start with Jim Boff for the closing remarks. And we will continue to go on the same way that we've been going. Jim.
Thank you. I would just like to say that I'm the candidate here, one of them that has now got some experience under his belt. I have been reasonable. I have actually talked to my opponent back in the fall, who told me that he really didn't have anything that he didn't think I was doing at the time, but that he thought his leadership style was better than mine. So if you're going to be voting style points, I'll concede those to him. He's also made it sound as if we're about to run out of water because of some lack of something the board has or has not done, but at least this board has gotten the mayor to clearly say he will not turn off the water. I think that's a big step. It certainly makes it clearer in my mind. Finally, my opponent has a business that he has to run. His general lack of attendance at most other kind of meetings, except for the town hall meeting about water, has been noticeable, and I don't think that that will improve if you were elected commissioner. So in a nutshell, what I'm saying is, if you're going to vote, please vote for experience, not Derucki.
Eight's enough. I'm for term limits. The incumbents had eight years. 8 years is enough. It's time for some new ideas. We need to get rid of the wasteful spending. We need to look at ways to lower taxes, or at least, like we said, maintain them. And give the perception that we have, not just perception, but actually follow through with it, that our ethics are above reproach, and that we have transparency in our government that we're always talking about. Taxes are continuous. We see what's happening in Washington. We don't need it here at the local level. Restoring America does not start in Washington, D.C. It starts right here in Forsyth County with we the people. I would ask for everyone's prayers and vote, and if elected, I will make a difference on this board. Thank you.
Last conversation I had with my wife before I decided to announce that I was going to run for county commissioner, she looked at me and she said, "Dear, do you think you can bite your tongue?" I said, "Yes." So tonight I'm going to go home and prove to her that I did that.
if we're going to run a clean race. In fact, in the spirit of cleanliness, I invite you to join me at the Fowler Park at 9 o'clock on Saturday. Keep Forsyth County beautiful, clean America. So we'll set that as our theme, so I won't respond to the Derucki comment. But saying that, you know, I don't need to attend the meetings. In today's technology, I can watch it all on a computer from my office, where I can take nice, clean little notes and keep track of things. You know, I'm not a politician. I'm not looking for another title. The best title I ever had was when my kids were little and they looked at me and they called me Dad. So to me, that's what it's all about. You know, I'm here because part of what I think is required of a county commissioner is selfless service. It's not the amount of time that you put into this or the time that you have available, it's the quality of time that you do that. And holding you people who haven't stepped on this side of the table near and dear to our heart and remembering what those values that you were raised on and bringing that to this board of commissioners. That's why I'm here. I mean, I get tired of the survival island. And when I look at the current board, and I'm not going to pick anyone name now, I'm bothered by it. And that's why this room is full tonight. You folks are bothered by it, I'm willing to step up and do something about it. I'm going to work hard at it, and I hope that I get around and I knock on your door and I introduce you and I shake your hand and I tell you who I am and what I'm all about, because this is from the heart. That's simple. Thank you, and I look forward to your support.
First of all, I'd like to just take this time to thank everyone who came and participated. I thank each one of the people that's here. And I'm a rookie. If I'm elected, I'll be a rookie. And I'm going to mess up, I'm sure. But I'm not going to sit up here and tell you I'm perfect, because I am not. But I will listen to you. That's one thing when you ask anybody about me that knows me, I will listen to you and I will talk with you. And I am one that'll get in there, and I'm bad. You know, I made some statements tonight that may blow some minds about going north. But we need to look at things. And if I'm wrong, okay, help me. Let's help one another, because this county water's going to be our main thing here in a few years, because we're getting to the point there's a lot of population. And we need to always be concerned about water. I believe we've worried more about recreation than we have what we need, a source of water. Without water, we die. I mean, that's just the way it is, and everybody's going to start running out and drilling wells and whatnot. There's going to be a lot of people very upset. So we need to be thinking ahead, not thinking and looking at right now. We need to think ahead. But if I'm elected, I'll do the best that I can to serve you. And to be a servant, that's the only reason I'm running, to be a servant of the people. And that's the way I look at it. I'll be here on account of you. I don't want to tie. Lord knows I don't want to tie. But I felt the need and the desire in my heart to put myself out here for these. Not for a want, but for what I feel. And that's the way I feel tonight. Thank you.
Charles.
Thank you. I stand behind my record of leadership. I stand behind my record that I developed in my tour duty in the Duluth City Council. I stand behind my record of service. I pledge to you that all that service would entail. And I truly do thank you for attending this meeting tonight. I look forward to meeting you. I look forward to working with you in the weeks ahead. Again, a special thanks to the Tea Party for having this event. Appreciate it.
Cindy?
I'd like to take this time to thank the Tea Party for having the event and for thanking all these gentlemen for stepping up to the plate and running for office. I believe that a lady will bring a new interest to the board that will represent a gender that needs to be represented. I feel like that I can bring something to this table from all my past work experience. I think you can talk to anybody that's went to church with me, and they'll tell you, I don't do anything halfway. I mean, if I do a job, I'm going to work hard at it, and I'm going to see it all the way through. I know it's going to be a challenging job. I know that we're going to have issues that are going to be tough ones to have to deal with just all with the money shortage, with everything that we're facing. But I feel like I'm up to the challenge, and that I have my heart's in the right place, and I'm doing it for the right reasons. My niece that's here tonight, Caroline, was in her eighth grade class recently, and they were discussing voting by district, and a young girl shouted out, I don't know what district I live in, but that lady named Cindy definitely lives in District 4. And I appreciated the fact that she had noticed my signs and that she saw and called attention that she knew that I lived in District 4, because it's something I have been so proud of my entire life, is where I come from. And I'm very proud of the district that my family's eight generations into that district, and it's something that I would serve that district with such pride. And I put my name big on the signs with Cindy because I wanted people to know that I'm just Cindy, and I'll always be just Cindy, and I'll be a person that you can call on that for help, for questions, and I'll just be a Cindy that you can trust. A lot of you here tonight are people that I know and love. I want to thank you the most for the way you've always loved me and for the way you're supporting me now. Together, I feel like we can restore our faith in government. Please vote for me, Cindy, on July 31st.
Bill?
Yes, indeed. Also, the Bill spell and Bill thing is really confusing. You know, I'll kind of comment on John here. My wife said the exact opposite thing. She said, quit complaining, get off the couch, and get out there and do something about it. Community service is a big aspect of our lives, and it has been since the day we moved in. My wife and I both volunteer a lot with a lot of different charities, and so on, board of directors, and go to my website, you can read all that. But I'm a simple guy. I have a little 6/10 of an acre lot up in North Forsyth, right down the road from Lanier Land. I don't have any property under conservation use, never have. I am the only candidate, and I'm speaking strictly for District 4, I'm the only candidate who's filed a financial disclosure statement with the state. Now, this is something that has to be done by June, but you can do it on January 1st, because it tells things such as what LLCs your shareholders in, or what property you actually own. Because according to our tax records, 2 out of the 5 candidates for District 4 don't even own property in this county. I do. This is a very important place to live. I love it here. But you know, bottom line, I'm not the standard good old boy candidate. If you like the good old boy way of doing business, you got plenty of folks to choose from. That's not me. I'm here to represent the homeowners. I'm here to represent people who, just like me, just want to trust that their county is in safe hands, that somebody has their back, somebody's championing them, and they don't have to worry about getting steamrolled by their own government. Thank you.
And finally, Dr. Bell.
Thanks, Steve. Once again, thanks to the Forsyth County Tea Party for hosting this debate. Yesterday, after I got home from church, I was fiddling around the house and began thinking about this debate and the issues that we would like to hear. And something puzzled me. Take a moment to think about Forsyth County, if you would. Reality is, Forsyth County is a great place to live, work, and play. My opponents would like to paint a picture of gloom and doom, but don't let them put one over on you. Forsyth County is a great place and is in great shape. Think about it. Our departments are recognized nationally, regionally, and throughout the state. Our school system is one of the best, hands down. Forsyth County's been named as one of the best places to get ahead, among other prestigious honors. Financially, you couldn't ask for a better county. Forsyth County has the lowest millage rate in Metro Atlanta. I was on the Finance Committee when we eliminated nearly $20 million in operational expense. Forsyth County's received excellence awards for transparency in accounting and earned a AAA bond rating. It's not gloom and doom. Yeah, we still got work to do, but I'm proud of what's been accomplished since I've been on the board. This county is in great shape. No, it's not as bad as they'd like you to believe, but then again, they need a platform to be relevant and have attempted to create a reason for you to be unhappy. Why? They need you to be unhappy in order for them to get reelected. Ladies and gentlemen, this is no time for innuendo, rhetoric, sound bites. It's no time for inexperience. It's no time for bitterness about lost contracts. No time for personal agendas. No time for overwhelming conflicts. No time to stack the board with family and friends. And no time to try to buy a seat on this board of commissioners. It's certainly no time for quiet leadership. It's time to ensure you continue bold representation on the board, time to continue shrinking government, continue eliminating government interference, and continue my initiatives to eliminate bureaucracy and continue to make Forsyth County a friendlier place to do business. Thank you for taking time out of your busy day to come tonight and for caring about our great county. I humbly ask for your support and we consider it an honor to receive your vote. Good night. Good night.
If you candidates want to go out and that way you can meet people as they're leaving, that might be a good idea. Thanks for coming, everyone. And yeah, please look around your seat and give us a ride. We have a little room in exactly the manner that we found it. Next month, we'll be here with the other space. Thank you.
You too. What did you say?
Thank you.
Thanks for being here.
I don't want to live here, but you're special, you see? And, I can't support the policy, I didn't live.